Recorded Books presents Harlem Godfather, The Rap on My Husband, Ellsworth Bumpy Johnson, by Mayme Johnson and Karen E. Quinones, narrated by Patricia R. Floyd. Harlem Godfather, The Rap on My Husband, Ellsworth Bumpy Johnson. Foreword by Shannon Holmes. Underworld organized crime figures from other ethnic groups have long been held in high esteem for their criminal exploits, evidence of which can be seen throughout every media outlet, from magazines, books, to film. These criminals are well documented throughout the annals of history. Hollywood has especially taken up position to glamorize and romanticize their life stories, making a handsome profit in the process. Movies depicting these Caucasian criminals, many of which, like The Godfather, are considered American cinematic classics. They live on long after the person in question has passed away, later to be discovered by other unsuspecting generation after generation. Even today, urban youths have taken such a liking to the criminal lore that even some rappers and producers have adopted their monikers in part or in whole, i.e., Irv Gotti, as an alias. It is rare, if ever, that such an honor is bestowed on an African-American gangster. But if there was a black criminal who deserves that tribute, then that person would be Ellsworth Bumpy Johnson. Before there was a Nicky Barnes, Guy Fisher, Freddie Myers, or even modern-day drug lords like Alpo and Rich Porter, there was Bumpy Johnson, the Harlem Godfather. Nowadays, the streets of Harlem languish in a state of uncertainty. With the drug game in shambles, there is no clear-cut leader on the streets. There is no organization that exerts total control. Once upon a time ago, there was. Bumpy Johnson and his cohorts ruled Black Harlem with an iron fist. Nothing illegal happened unless he gave the word. He was the man before my generation knew who or what the man was. Bumpy was a man amongst men. He was a true stand-up guy who took on the upper echelons of the mafia and won. Way back when, America was looked upon by foreigners as the land of opportunity. But here at home in the United States, the black man couldn't even find decent work to feed his family. Foreigners routinely came from across seas and took all the best jobs, even in the criminal realm. Time and time again, the black man was underestimated and overlooked. Conditions such as these spurred many law-abiding black men to enter into a life of crime. They merely took the bitter fruit, the lemons, that the corrupt political infrastructure gave them and made sweet lemonade. From the undercarriage of society, the have-nots were born. From humble beginnings came a true American gangster. When the streets of New York were ripe for the taking, Bumpy Johnson carved out his own piece of the American dream. This man was larger than life. In between these pages lie the answers to the mystery surrounding his life. See why Bumpy Johnson was reviled by some, loved by many, but respected by all. Chapter 1, Godfather of Harlem. It wasn't unusual for a gunshot victim to be wheeled into the operating room of Sydenham Hospital in Harlem in 1952, especially in the wee hours of the morning, when club hoppers with too much to drink took their 9-to-5 frustrations out on whoever was available. But this was no usual gunshot victim. This was my husband, Ellsworth Bumpy Johnson. the man who, according to legend, almost single-handedly fought the infamous Jewish hoodlum Dutch Schultz when that notorious madman tried to take over the Harlem numbers rackets. The man who was as well known for his charity to children as for his deadly temper when he was crossed by other gangsters. The man who was the undisputed king of the Harlem underworld. The man to whom I'd been married only 3 years. And from the looks of things, the 45-year-old man who was about to take his last breath. Bumpy, Detective Philip Kleiger yelled as he trotted alongside the gurney, towing the bloodied, half-conscious man.
You know you're not going to make it. Tell me who shot you so we can bring him to justice.
But see, my husband lived by the gangster code. Bumpy opened his eyes and momentarily focused on the detective, and his slackened lips curled into a snarl.
A man can only die once, and dead men make no excuses.
He managed to get out before falling into full unconsciousness.
Lord!
Screamed a heavily painted woman with a crimson dress two sizes too tight and about 6 inches too short.
That boy done kill Bumpy.
That boy, I found out later, was 31-year-old Everett Loving, also known as Robert Hawk Hawkins, a brash young gambler from Asheville, North Carolina, who fancied himself a pimp and was considered simply a joke by the Harlem hustlers.
The kid was nothing but a punk,
legendary card sharp Finley Hoskins would say later.
No one ever paid him no mind. No one ever had no reason to.
But in June 1952, the tall, dark-skinned Hawk was determined to make someone take him seriously. He desperately wanted to be accepted by the Harlem hustlers, whose number he so urgently wanted to join. He wanted to impress them. He needed to make a name for himself. For those of you who don't know, New York bars and clubs are open until 4 a.m., but for serious partiers, that's still way too early to go home. These folks would then head for the illegally run after-hour joints. True, there were some joints that you had to knock on the door and say, Joe sent me, or give some kind of password. But many others operated in plain view. As long as the owners made their weekly donations to the police, no one bothered them. The Vets Club, which was located at 122nd Street and St. Nicholas Avenue, was owned by John Levy, the abusive boyfriend-slash-manager of jazz great Billie Holiday, and Vincent Nelson, one of the most successful pimps in Harlem. By 3 a.m., the joint would be jumping and the folks would be stomping. There was always a good time and a good crowd at the Vets. On this particular night, jazz great Sarah Vaughan was there sipping champagne, along with the Brown twins, Vivian and Hibby, a popular dance duo. The gorgeous vamp, Marguerite Chapman, who would later marry baseball slugger Willie Mays. She was a lot older than him, but she lied to him about her age. Was there also, along with a couple of black Hollywood starlets who wished they looked as good as Marguerite. And R&B diva Dinah Washington was holding court to her usual entourage of 10 or 12. It was about 5:30 a.m. when the already half-drunk Hawk sauntered over to the bar and ordered a scotch, then proceeded to loudly talk about his take for the night, the trick money his bitches had turned over to him after a night of whoring.
Man, why don't you cool out? Can't you see there's ladies in here?
Show some respect, Bumpy said irritably as he clinked the ice in his watered-down glass of ginger ale. As bad as Bumpy was,
he didn't like men cursing around women they didn't know. To be honest, I don't believe Hawk even looked up to see that it was Bumpy, because he would have been stupid to say what he said next.
"Nigger, who the fuck is you to tell me to cool out?"
he yelled in his heavy southern accent. Bumpy looked him up and down and then said quietly, "I'm about to be your worst nightmare. Now carry your behind out of here before someone has to carry you out." This time, Hawk did look up before saying anything else. And that's when he realized who it was he'd been addressing. Intoxicated but not stupid, Hawk turned to leave, but stumbled over a chair on the way out. Someone snickered, and Hawk angrily whirled around to say something, but Bumpy looked at him with an icy stare and said, "You still here?" Ego bruised, Hawk left. Bumpy bought a round of drinks for the ladies as an apology for the rudeness of the younger man, and the merriment continued, as it had been before the intrusion. An hour later, most of the partygoers were gone, and my husband was standing at the bar talking to the bartender and the club owners, John Levy and Vincent Nelson, when he suddenly felt a nudge on his shoulder and turned around. Hawk had topped off the scotch he'd already imbibed with cheap wine. And armed with liquid courage and a borrowed revolver, he had come back to seek his revenge.
"What you got to say now, nigger?"
he screamed as he shakily pointed the gun at Bumpy's head.
"You so fucking bad. What you gotta say now?"
Bumpy was out on bail and carried no knife or gun. And because he was backed up against the bar, there was no way he could escape.
"Man, why don't you go home and sleep it off?" Bumpy said calmly as he stretched his hand out behind him, hoping to grasp something on the bar that he could use as a weapon. "You were wrong, and you got called out on it. It's over now."
"Ain't shit over!"
Hawk yelled as he stepped back and tightened his finger on the trigger to take his shot. But just then, Bumpy managed to grab a potted plant and smashed it into the side of Hawk's face. It was enough to throw off Hawk's aim, and the bullet, meant for Bumpy's head, slammed into the right side of his chest instead. And two more shots barreled into his stomach. Bumpy slumped to the floor, eyes closed, and for a moment, Hawk stood over him, as if just realizing what he'd done. But when Bumpy reopened his eyes, and Hawk realized he was still alive, Hawk flew out the door.
"Bumpy, are you all right?"
the bartender asked, as he, Vince, and Levy rushed over to the fallen man.
"I'm fine,"
Bumpy said in a weak and shaky voice.
"Just help me to my feet."
Levy and the bartender half carried Bumpy to Vince's car, and they sped off to Sydenham Hospital on 124th Street and Manhattan Avenue. As Vince helped Bumpy up the stairs, another gambler and pimp, Gershwin Miles, called from across the street.
"Bumpy, is that you? You all right, man?"
"Nah, man, I've been shot,"
Bumpy managed to yell back to his friend. No lie, it seemed like all of Harlem must have been listening, because within 10 minutes, the hospital was filled with people trying to see what had happened to Bumpy. I was home, asleep, when Vincent called to tell me what had happened. I almost had a heart attack right there in bed when he said,
"Mayme, you better hurry. The doctors aren't sure he's going to make it."
Bumpy and I had only been married 3 years. And while I knew there was always a chance,
he'd get hurt in his line of work. Somehow it never occurred to me that he might be killed, and I would be a widow. Call me naive. I wanted to break down in tears, but I didn't have time. My man was in trouble, and I had to get to him as soon as possible. I couldn't waste any time going into hysterics. We were living at 2 West 120th Street on the third floor at the time, and Walter Clark, who owned the then famous but now defunct Uncle Walter's Sausage, lived on the sixth floor. I hurriedly called his wife, Willa Mae, and asked her to rush downstairs to take care of Bumpy's 2-year-old granddaughter, Margaret. Then I got dressed and was downstairs in less than 5 minutes. I hadn't thought about how I would get to the hospital, but I needn't have worried. Vince was already outside the building in his long black Cadillac. He must have sped through every single red light to make it there that fast. I hopped in the car, and it seemed it was only a few minutes later that we were at Sydenham Hospital. We pulled up in front of the hospital, and I believe I actually jumped out the car before Vince even had the chance to put the car in park. As I ran up the steps, I heard someone call out, "Mayme, let him know I'm here, but I can't come in." I looked around and saw a dope dealer named George Iser peeking out from the bushes. "There's cops in there, and I still got warrants on me," he explained. "But I just want to make sure Bumpy's okay. Let him know I'm out here." I quickly nodded before walking into the hospital. The lobby was packed with people. It seemed like hundreds of people. There were people there in their nightclubbing clothes, men there with pants pulled on over their pajamas, women with coats thrown over their nightgowns, and detectives, doctors and nurses all over the place. It was just ridiculous. I actually had to push my way in. Haas Steele, Junie Bird, Finley Hoskins, Steve Mitchell, John Levy, and Georgie Rose, all of whom had known Bumpy from when he first moved to Harlem as a teenager, were already there. Steve gave a yell when he saw me, and he and Vince shoved people out the way to get me to the doctor so I could sign the papers for them to operate. It was only then that I saw Bumpy, as they were wheeling him into the operating room. There were two detectives running alongside the gurney, and I had to push them aside to get to my husband. I almost fainted when I looked at him. His beautiful chocolate complexion was an ashen gray, and his beautiful almond-shaped brown eyes were glazed and only half open. I fought back a sob as I reached for his hand and gave a reassuring squeeze. To my delight, he was able to give a weak squeeze back in return. It re-strengthened me. "Will you get the hell out of here?" I screamed at the detectives, who now had the nerve to try to push me out the way to continue questioning Bumpy.
"You heard, Mrs. Johnson," I heard a voice behind me say. "Please get out the way so we can get this man into the operating room."
I turned around and saw Dr. Harold Wardrow, a well-known black surgeon, standing there with a scowl on his face. The operation took 6 hours, and when it was over, Dr. Wardrow came over and told me,
"Mrs. Johnson, had the bullet in his chest been 1/110 of an inch to the left, it would have pierced his heart, and we wouldn't be here speaking now, because your husband would be dead. And to be honest, we've done all we can, but it'll still be touch and go for the next few days. I suggest that you pray for your husband's survival."
I immediately sank to my knees there in the hospital waiting room, clasped my hands together, and looked up toward heaven. "Dear Lord," I said,
I know that my husband hasn't always been the most upright citizen, but he's always been an upright man. And I love him very much, dear Lord. Please don't take Bumpy away from me.
I stayed on my knees for another 15 minutes, sending up prayer after prayer. When I got up and turned to face Ha Steele, Junie Bird, Vince Nelson, John Levy, Richie Williams, and George Rose, I was surprised and touched to see tears in their eyes. These men were considered to be some of the toughest men in Harlem, and they were on the verge of breaking down with emotion. Suddenly, Steve cleared his throat and spoke.
Look, the doctors done all they could, and Mayme got the God thing in hand. Let's go get out in the street and kill that punk motherfucker Hawk.
Without another word, they all walked out the hospital and got in their cars and sped off. They never did find Hawk, though. We found out later that once he ran out the vets club, he got in the car and drove to Albany, New York, and hid out there before finally hightailing it back to North Carolina. Bumpy's operation was on Monday, but by the time the Amsterdam News, a well-known African-American newspaper in New York, which still operates today, hit the stands on Thursday, he was still in a coma. Their headlines screamed, "Bumpy Johnson near death after being shot during after-hour spot brawl." The nuns at the Sisters of Handmaid of Mary lit candles and prayed for his recovery. Harlem luminaries called the hospital every hour to check on his prognosis. And Harlem sporting men and women gathered together in their familiar haunts while they awaited word on the condition of their unofficial leader. Al Capone may have ruled Chicago. Lucky Luciano may have run most of New York City. But when it came to Harlem, the man in charge was my man, Bumpy Johnson. He was called an old-fashioned gentleman. He was called a pimp, a philanthropist, and a thief, a scholar and a thug, a man who admonished children to stay in school, and a man who District Attorney William O'Brien once said was the most dangerous man in New York. Bumpy was a man whose contradictions are still the root of many an argument in Harlem. But there is one thing on which everybody could agree. In his lifetime, Ellsworth Bumpy Johnson was the man in Harlem. If you wanted to do anything in Harlem, anything at all, you'd better stop and see Bumpy, because he ran the place. Want to open a number spot on the avenue? Go see Bumpy. Thinking about converting your brownstone into a speakeasy? Check with Bumpy first. The police knew it. They came to him to negotiate peace between young street gangs. The politicians knew it. They counted on him to deliver votes on election day. Even the Italian and Jewish syndicate knew it, although they had to find out the hard way. When they decided to move on the Harlem numbers racket, Bumpy, only 25 at the time, sprang into action. With only a handful of loyal men behind him, Bumpy waged a successful guerrilla war, forcing the white mobsters to finally come to terms with that crazy nigga. Even Lucky Luciano, the head of organized crime in New York City, publicly gave Bumpy his due. Black Harlem only recognized one crime boss, and that was Bumpy Johnson. Bumpy was willing to use his fists and his guns to get what he wanted, but he was just as willing to use his money to help Harlemites in need. If he saw a family's furniture being moved out in the street because they couldn't pay the landlord, not an uncommon sight in Depression-era Harlem, he would reach into his pocket and peel off a few large bills from the huge wad he carried and hand it to the evictors to pay off the back rent.
Each year, Bumpy personally threw huge Christmas parties at the Rhythm Club on 7th Avenue and spent thousands of dollars on those economically deprived children Santa Claus always seemed to forget. Yes, Bumpy may have been a criminal, but he was a criminal with a social conscience. In this community that felt exploited and abused by both the government and the white criminal element, Bumpy was an underworld leader who took from the people, but at least gave something back. Me? I don't know. I knew who and what Bumpy was when I met him, and I never did intend to fall in love with him. But I did, and I fell hard. I was born in North Carolina, not far from Asheville. My parents were sharecroppers, and we were poor, very poor. And I knew from a very early age that I didn't like being poor. And people started telling me at a very early age that with my looks, I wouldn't have to be poor long. I was what they called light, bright, and damn near white, with straight, light brown hair that hung down my back. By the time I was 14, men were already beginning to notice me. Problem was, there in the backwoods of North Carolina, the men who were noticing me weren't about anything and had no prospect of ever being about anything. I wasn't what you called a bad girl, but I was certainly looking for a way out of North Carolina and away from the smell of wet tobacco. I had a series of male callers. And like many young girls getting a lot of male attention, I made some mistakes. One of them resulted in me being a single mother at age 20. And let me tell you, being a single mother in 1934 was a lot different than being a single mother in 2004. My family was scandalized. And people would whisper and point and discourage their young daughters being around because I was fast. It was hard, but I swallowed their crap, but never my pride, and kept my head high. I think that's when I learned to just ignore what people said and to just keep on keeping on. It served me well later on in life. In 1938, my father died, and we had to borrow money to bury him since he didn't have life insurance. I was working as a live-in domestic in Durham at the time, making $4 a week. My sister Lucille lived in New York City, and she encouraged me to come up north because I could make more money, which I could then send home to the family to help pay the burial debt. So I left my daughter Ruthie with my mother and headed to Harlem. The first job I got was as a lady's maid for a white woman named Mildred Lapkin. I didn't stay there long, though. One of the domestics who lived in the building next door said, "Girl, you way too good looking to be doing someone's laundry. You better use your looks to get you a job to make some real money. Or better yet, get you a man who got some real money and willing to give you some." I didn't think about it 2 minutes before I knew she was right. I like to stay dressed well and go out and have a good time. The $8 a week I got working for the Lapkin household didn't go far, especially since I was sending most of that home to my mother to help pay bills. It wasn't long before I landed a real cushy job as hostess at Hagar's Barbecue. Hagar's was right off the Harlem River Speedway near 180th Street and was owned by actress-singer Ethel Waters. She named it after the character Hagar she played in the celebrated Broadway play Mamba's Daughters in 1939. In 1940, when I got the job at Hagar's, Ethel was one of the highest-paid black actresses in Hollywood. She starred in the all-black musical revue, Cabin in the Sky, and also played the grandmother in the movie Pinky, which was about a black woman passing for white. And she also had a nightclub act and an evening radio show. Ethel was famous and rich, but could be a real bitch, if you don't mind my saying. She wasn't much to look at and was jealous as hell of anyone who was. And she really hated on people who had talent that might rival hers. She used to badmouth people like Sarah Vaughan, saying she could sing circles around that girl. And she really hated on Lena Horne, especially when Lena got the lead part in the 1943 movie Stormy Weather with Bill Bojangles Robinson. Ethel swore she was the one who made the song Stormy Weather famous when she sang it at the Cotton Club back in the early 1930s. And Lena couldn't do the song justice. They say she gave Lena pure hell when they starred together in Cabin in the Sky, because she thought the crew was paying too much attention to her. A lot of people in show business respected Ethel Waters, but they didn't like her. And not too many people at the restaurant liked her either. She was the boss, and she wanted everyone to know it. Everyone at Hagar's was afraid of her and jumped whenever they heard her voice, including her husband, Eddie Mallory. Eddie, who was about 10 years younger than Ethel, used to have quite a name himself back in the 30s as a trumpet player and band leader. But you'd never know it the way Ethel talked to him. He said he didn't mind, though, as long as she paid the bills. And boy, did she pay some bills keeping that man dressed. Whoo! Eddie was always sharp and always in brand new sporty cars, which he used to escort beautiful young girls around whenever Ethel was out of town, which was quite often because of her career. I'm not going to lie and say that Ethel was ever particularly mean to me, but I didn't like her because of the way she treated everyone else. Maybe that's why I went along with the bartender's scheme to steal from her club every night. Or maybe it was simply because, like I said earlier, I liked having money. I was making $3 a week salary at Hagar's, but I was actually bringing home something close to $60 a week because I earned about $12 a night in tips. Believe me, $60 a week was crazy money back in the early 40s. I was able to send my mother $30 or $40 a week and still have enough to dress nice and go out and have a good time. But when the bartender approached me with his little scheme, I started making even more money. The scheme was simple. If a customer gave me a $5 to get him a drink from the bar, I'd order the drink, hand the bartender the money, and he would hand me back change for a $20. I'd give the customer back his correct change and pocket the rest. The bartender and I would then split our take at the end of our shift. We did this for years and never got caught. The weeks that bartender and I worked the same shifts, I was able to bring home about $200 a week instead of $60. Now, I wasn't only able to buy nice dresses, I was able to buy them at some of the nicer downtown boutiques. I was also able to afford a move from Harlem into a nice little apartment at 86th Street in Central Park West. The landlord and all the other tenants thought I was white, and I didn't tell them any different. I was young, and I was enjoying myself. You're supposed to do that when you're young. I thought that then, and I still think so now. I went out a lot during that time. Men were always asking me out, and I often went. I wasn't going to bed with them, but I did let them take me out and show me a good time. Nothing wrong with that. And I was always most attracted to men who had money. I always said, you don't need a man who doesn't have money because you can do bad by yourself. One guy I was really attracted to, though, was John Levy. I knew his sister, Gert, and she introduced us. This was about 1945. He used to come into Hagar's all the time and ask me out. I was kind of leery at first, because I had heard his reputation as a ladies' man. But after a while, I let my guard down and went out with him. John was a good-looking man and such a sweet talker, and he showed me such a good time. Before I knew it, we were at his house, and I was sitting on the bed with my shoes off. I knew what was coming next, but I didn't care. I was really feeling John Levy. That is, until suddenly, someone started banging on his door, screaming in a high-pitched female voice,
"John, you no good nigga. I know you got some woman in there. You got me out here whoring in the street, and your no-good ass is cheating on me with some bitch."
Well, John hurried up and hustled me inside a closet and pleaded for the woman on the other side of the door to go away, saying he was just in there by himself trying to get some sleep. She finally left after about a half hour, and he let me out the closet. I didn't say a word to him. I politely put on my shoes, picked up my pocketbook, and caught a cab home. I didn't want anything else to do with John Levy. He might have been good-looking and a sweet talker, but no man was worth fighting over, in my opinion. Besides, from what I could gather from the things being said by the woman banging on the door, John was a man who took money from women. Hell, he'd want to pimp me and I'd want to pimp him. Wasn't going to work. And I found out later, if John didn't get what he wanted from a woman fast enough, he'd beat the hell out of her. He hooked up with blues great Billie Holiday in the late 40s while she was still married to Jimmy Monroe. And it was a shame the way he treated that poor woman. He used to beat her right out there on the street. On 7th Avenue. It was she who put up most of the bankroll for him to open the Vets Club. And years later, I can remember him bringing her to a party Bumpy and I had after we moved into the Lenox Terrace. She was all bruised and looked like she was crying. And John, bold as day, said,
"Bumpy, come here, I got something to show you."
He pulled out a pair of her exquisite and expensive gold-encrusted jade earrings from his pocket and offered to sell them to Bumpy right in front of everybody. Billy didn't say anything. She just averted her eyes in shame. Bumpy was disgusted. John was his boy from way back, but Bumpy liked Billy and didn't think John had to embarrass her like that, selling her jewelry at a party right in front of her. Bumpy pulled out $50 and gave it to John, then snatched the earrings out his hand. I think he did it so John wouldn't go around hawking it to other people at the party and shame poor Billy even more. After the party, Bumpy gave me the earrings and said he never wanted to see them again. I still have those earrings. John was a real bastard. That woman banging on the door when she did back in 1945 might have been the best thing that happened to me. By 1946, I had enough of Hagar's. It was true, I was making good money, but I wasn't finding any good men. I decided to try my luck downtown. And I landed a job as hostess at a restaurant called King of the Sea at 53rd Street and 3rd Avenue. I started dating a couple of white men, but I wasn't into anything serious. Then one April evening in 1948, I went uptown to eat at Frazier's restaurant at 122nd and 7th because I had a taste for some good chicken and everyone knew that Frazier's had the best food in Harlem. I had just ordered my food when this good-looking, dark-skinned man walked in and took a seat. He was smiling and laughing and told Mona Frazier that he'd just gotten arrested.
I thought that was strange that someone would think it funny that they were arrested. So I listened more intently. He said that he was collecting numbers on 135th Street when he noticed a police officer walking his way. He said he didn't know this officer, and he didn't want to take any unnecessary chances. So he threw the brown paper bag with the numbers in the gutter and kept walking.
"But wouldn't you know," he said, "one of the kids who's always hanging around yelled out behind me,
'Mr. Bumpy, you dropped your bag.'
I tried to just keep walking, but the kid picked up the bag and chased after me to give it to me. I couldn't even be mad at the boy because he was trying to do the right thing. Of course, what wound up happening was he got me arrested."
Bumpy started cracking up with his laughter again, and so did Mona. And my ears perked up. Bumpy? Was this the infamous Bumpy Johnson who everyone was talking about? I didn't want it to be obvious, so I tried looking at him from the corner of my eyes. For someone who was supposed to be the toughest man in Harlem, he didn't look all that big. He was about 5'8", with a medium build, chocolate complexion, and neatly groomed short hair. He had almond-shaped eyes that twinkled when he laughed. He was a good-looking man. Not pretty, but very handsome. Add to that the fact that I knew he had money, and he was downright gorgeous. Bumpy had just finished doing a 10-year stint in Dannemora for slicing up a pimp called New York Charlie, so I had never had the opportunity to meet him. Now was my chance. I pulled my chair a little away from the table, crossed my legs, and waited for him to notice me in my shocking pink sweater and my form-fitting black velvet skirt. I didn't have to wait long.
"Hey, who's that fine young foxy filly?"
I heard him ask Mona. She told him that my name was Mayme something, and I was up from North Carolina and worked as a hostess at the King of the Sea. He told her that he wanted to buy me a drink, and Mona came up and told me that Bumpy wanted to treat me to a drink. I turned and flashed him a smile, then told Mona to tell him that I didn't drink. Well, he was at my table in just a few seconds, insisting that his day just wouldn't be complete if he couldn't persuade me to just have one little drink on him. I gave a big sigh and said if it meant that much to him, perhaps I'd have a blackberry brandy. He smiled and asked if he could join me at my table. I gave a half smile and a slight shrug. That was all the encouragement Bumpy needed. He sat down and proceeded to tell me all about him. I pretended I'd never heard of him. Learned everything he could about me. I was careful to leave out anything I thought might turn him off. And then he went on to tell me his views on all the current events of the time. I was impressed. This was a really smart man. 2 hours had passed, and we decided to leave the restaurant and go to the movies. It was raining, but we drove to the Strand, which was a huge theater house on Broadway between 48th and 49th Streets. Back in the early 1900s, it was a vaudeville stage, but in 1948, it was a first-run movie theater. So I don't know why it was playing To Be or Not to Be, which was first released in 1942. But it was. I'd seen the movie before, but I didn't tell Bumpy. And since it was a good movie, I didn't mind seeing it again. I always did like the star Carol Lombard. She was the wife of movie king Clark Gable and had died in an airplane crash in a few months before the movie was released. Afterward, we went to the apartment he was staying in on 149th Street and Broadway. I couldn't very well take him to my apartment because all my neighbors thought I was white, remember? And there was no way Bumpy was passing for white.
I figured I'd go upstairs with him to his apartment. He would try to get me in bed, and I would play hard to get and go home, making him want me all the more. To my surprise, Bumpy never made a pass. We stayed up all night talking. I don't think I'd ever done that with a man before. I was intrigued, and he made me laugh. He was doing impersonations and serenading me with the song It Had to Be You, which was featured in the film Casablanca. The Ink Spots had just sung the song on the Jack Benny radio show a few days earlier, and Bumpy was doing their version, and he had me cracking up with laughter. Oh, Bumpy was a man of many talents, but singing wasn't one of them. He didn't care, though. He was just hamming it up. Although I just met him that night, I was seeing a side of Bumpy that few people saw, and I was enjoying the hell out of it. We started going out on a regular basis, going to boxing matches, concerts, and nightclubs. That's when I found out that while Bumpy couldn't sing, he could dance his butt off. In fact, he actually won a couple of Charleston contests. He introduced me to his childhood friends, Nat Pettigrew, Ha Steele, Richie Williams, Steve Mitchell, Junie Bird, 6 and 8. Never did learn his real name. They called him 6 and 8 because he liked to shoot craps, and those were his favorite points. Georgie Rose and Finley Hoskins. Before long, I was known as Bumpy's Girl. It was a good title to possess. It meant I could get in anywhere I wanted to go. I was treated as queen wherever I went, and I was showered with gifts and jewelry on a steady basis. It also meant that I was constantly accosted by other women.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.